Okay, so this was my introduction, and happy to join this conference, and I think we go on, just not to lose any time. The second slide, please. So, as I just said, breast cancer surgery evolves significantly, with the radical mastectomy being the standard, then being replaced by modified radical mastectomy, which was possible due to the advent of multimodal treatment and systemic treatment. Breast conserving therapy, and with the improvement of early detection and improved imaging, for many patients, breast cancer surgery has become a minimally invasive procedure. Next slide, please. The introduction of sentinel biopsy was another milestone in surgical breast cancer treatment, allowing the staging of the axilla being performed with the resection of a very tiny amount of tissue compared to radical axillary resection, which was the standard of care for more than a century and which was associated with a huge morbidity. Next slide, please. Reconstructive techniques have evolved significantly with several autologous techniques with different implant-based techniques such as skin sparing, nipple sparing mastectomies, prepectoral, retropectoral expanders with several different covering devices. Next slide, please. However, the progress to adapt surgery to de-escalate strategy to the rapidly improving systemic treatment option is slower, as I will point out a little bit later. Reconstructive techniques are insufficiently available and insufficiently standardized, and sentinel biopsy is by far not available all over the world. Next slide, please. So how can we improve treatment? How can we improve research? And how can we improve quality-assured implementation of new procedures? Next slide, please. One example for the long time interval between a hypothesis, the available of research data, and the implementation of new strategies into clinical routine was the ACOSUCCESS-11 trial. In this trial, women with invasive breast cancer and sentinel node metastasis were randomized to undergo axillary resection versus no further axillary treatment. The results of this trial were presented 10 years ago, and the 10-year follow-up was presented at the ASCO meeting of 2017. However, next slide, please. Even 2019 international guidelines are completely different. The omission of axillary resection was described by the ASCO guidelines, or the level of evidence associated with omission is regarded as high by the ASCO guidelines, and the recommendation grade to omit axillary resection is high in the United States. According to German guidelines, the level of evidence is moderate, and the recommendation not to perform axillary resection in this group of patients is moderate. On the other hand, in Sweden, full axillary resection for patients who fulfill the ACOSUCCESS criteria is still the standard of care. So although data are available for more than a decade, international guidelines differ significantly. Next slide, please. So this is due mainly to the insufficient accrual of the patients. Only half of the planned cohort of 1,900 patients could be recruited. There are further limitations, as you may know, as the lack of standardization of the radiation fields or the high rate of micromets. So for these reasons, the results of the trial was not widely accepted. Next slide, please. So further confirmatory trials were needed, and five trials are currently running: the PASNOC trial in England, the Zinodar 1 in Italy, Zinomac in Sweden, and Enzima, the Rando 2 trial. And as you can see, the patient numbers again is high because different and recurrence rates is low. And you may acknowledge that it's difficult for a country like Sweden to randomize 3,500 patients in a study. The inclusion criteria, unfortunately, also different for the trials, making a comparison difficult, and the endpoint of the trials also difficult. And all this leads to the situation that accrual takes a long time for single countries, that trial results are not comparable because of different inclusion criteria and different endpoints. So the end of accrual for these four trials is between 2019 and 2021. Three of these trials have already stopped recruiting because of low accrual rate. And again, they have accrued only half of the planned patients. The results with regard to recurrences will be available only in 3 or 5 years. So this is a very long time period. Next slide, please. So what is the effect of this? And you can see here, this is what happened in Germany. This is the time point when the ACOSOC results were published. And from then on, the rate of axillary resection dropped constantly, but not because of new data, because surgeons were more and more convinced that this is the right way. But this attitude was not caused by evidence. It was just caused by some gut feeling, because the level of evidence was not higher in 2015 than it was in 2010. What happened again, this is an example from Germany, it depended largely on the feeling of the surgeon if he accepted the results of set 11 and believed in the evidence, or if he did not accept, because he did not accept the evidence. If the patient went to institution A, even in 2016, the probability of undergoing axillary resection was high, between 80 and 90%. And if the patient went to institution B, the probability of undergoing axillary resection was almost nothing. So the strategy depended largely on the surgeon's feeling. Next slide, please. Further studies like the AMROS trial and the IBCSG-123 trial, both studies examined the value of full axillary resection, stopped after accruing half of the planned patients. So none of the important randomized circular trials in recent years ever reached the accrual goal. Next slide, please. So the problem is that we have many and competing nationally organized trials. All of them require high patients number. But therefore, the accrual is slow and insufficient, because it's difficult to accrue many patients in a single country. And different endpoints make joint analysis difficult. So the effect is that there's a long time interval between hypothesis and availability of evidence based on practice-changing data. And new techniques are established without adequate evidence. Next slide, please. Another example for overlapping trial, we have 7 trials that examine the feasibility of different techniques for target axillary resection, all organized on a national basis. Next slide. Another example regarding reconstructive surgery. This is a Cochrane meta-analysis on the safety of nipple and areolar sparing mastectomy for the treatment of breast cancer, involving observational trials. So the findings from these trials, so the authors concluded that there was low quality evidence, were inconclusive for all outcomes. Next slide, please. Another multicenter prospective cohort study looked at the short-term safety outcomes for mastectomy and immediate implant-based reconstructions. And again, the authors concluded that complications after immediate implant-based breast reconstructions are higher than recommended by national standards. So a randomized clinical trial is needed to establish the optimal approach for immediate breast reconstruction. Next slide, please. So there is a need. Next slide, please. So there's a need to define gaps for clinical research, to conduct high-quality clinical trials, and to shorten the time interval between hypothesis and clinical implementation by the conduct of international cross-border studies. and the avoidance of overlapping trials by improving international cooperation. On the other hand, in order to improve the implementation of new surgical techniques, standardized training programs for a quality-assured implementation of new procedures are required. Next slide, please. Therefore, the work you're doing in the Central Eastern European Breast Cancer Consortium is exactly the way you have to proceed, and I congratulate for the tremendous achievement that you have performed during the last 2 years. On the other hand, next slide, please. As Zoltan already pointed out, it's important for all the initiatives and efforts to cooperate closely, and this is the European Breast Cancer Research Association of Surgical Trialists that was founded in 2018, exactly for the reason to overcome the problems I just mentioned in the conduct of clinical trials. Next slide, please. So the aim of UBREAST, what is UBREAST? It's a non-profit organization to promote the efficacy of clinical trials in the field of breast cancer surgery with the aim to adjust the extent of surgery to the improving success of systemic treatment and spare unnecessary morbidity. Next slide, please. So the objectives are to conduct high-quality cross-border trials with Europe and worldwide, to promote joint activities of breast surgeons, and we are happy to have a close cooperation with the Central Eastern European Breast Cancer Surgical Consortium. Next slide, please. So, however, there are also drawbacks, and one important drawback is the funding of clinical trials, which is mostly restricted to national accrual, and this is a real problem for the conduct of cross-border studies. So the improvement of international cooperation also requires political efforts. Next slide, please. This is the latest trial of the UBREAST group, which is open currently for accrual. It's the AXANA trial, axillary surgery after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. And as you know, there's currently no standard for the treatment of CN1 patients who convert to YCN0 under neoadjuvant chemotherapy. There are different standards all over the world. In Sweden, Norway, the northern country, axillary section is the standard of care. In some European countries, Germany, the Netherlands, targeted axillary section is the preferred method. In other countries like Italy, sentinel node dissection alone is accepted as procedure to stage these patients, although higher false negative rate has been reported in some studies. But it's important to know that currently no data are available to compare these three techniques with regard to outcome, morbidity, and costs. So therefore, next slide, please. The AXANA trial has been established. Next slide, please. The AXANA study has been established as a prospective registry, since it's almost important to compare all the different issues in a randomized trial. So we established a prospective registry. We want to include 3,000 patients, and the endpoints is invasive disease-free survival on one hand, and the second primary co-endpoint is life quality. And then I believe we will have clear data on to compare three competing surgical techniques. It's intended to collect data from all over Europe. Each country is represented in the steering committee, and we intend to accrue about 1,000 patients per year. Next slide, Pete. So anybody's interested and everybody is cordially invited, please contact UBREAST by our homepage or by contacting me or by email. Next slide, please. This is another important effort. Zoltan already reported about this. Not only clinical research is important, but also quality assured introduction of new techniques and training breast cancer. So the BRESSO initiative is a European platform on breast surgery accreditation. And as you can see, and Zoltan already showed the slides, every important breast surgical association is supporting this very important effort. So next slide. The objective of BRESO is to create a framework for accreditation, certification, and further education. It's to create a unique system and initiative for standardized training programs, to provide joint venture with key parties and cover all Europe, including Eastern European countries. Next slide, please. So in summary, this is not the last version, but I want to announce that BRESO has a website that is accessible since a few days, and I ask everyone really to contact this this website. So in summary, international cooperation is essential to provide evidence-based surgical care, to accelerate scientific progress, to provide optimal care to as many patients as possible by standardizing training programs. So thank you. Next slide. Thank you very much for attending the presentation. And I'm also open for questions. Thank you very much.